same.
Don't you know your life will turn around?
Resurrection power is.
I love it. The celebration continues. I'm so excited about this word because God will change your life as you understand what I'm preaching. People are living in the land according to Genesis chapter 12, and God said, I have given this to your seed. Can you imagine? God always speaks to our seed. They were not even born. Abraham didn't have a child, and God was speaking to his children. But spiritually and naturally, he's speaking to us. Hallelujah. It's powerful. So he raised an altar unto the Lord who appeared unto him. And he removed, I'm reading verse 8 now, and he removed from thence unto a mountain and the east of Bethel and pitched his tent, having Bethel on the west and Hai on the east. You see, Bethel, the house of God, and the, you know, the fruitful land, and Hai is a heap of ruins. Glory. And there, watch this, he built an altar unto the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. Who taught him this? God taught him this. You move from where God appeared to you, and then you go and position between two extremities. One is blessed, one is chaos. And he raised an altar in the middle. And you breach the two destinies. And then you cause the glory to flow from the direction of the blessing into where the curse is. These things are amazing. It's there in the Word. And we haven't noticed all these years. That's what we did in this place. That's what we did to change this city called Union City. Hallelujah. And he called upon the name of the Lord. And Abraham journeyed going on still toward the south. God kept telling, move, move, move. But look at this, verse 10, and there was a famine in the land. And Abraham went down into Egypt to sojourn there. Boom, there you go. He kept journeying and journeying. Why was he journeying? I guess he was looking for a place without trouble, a place where there was no famine. And then finally, he just turned around and went to Egypt, which is what has happened to us. When we go through dreary times, difficult times, then we go back to Egypt. We go back to sin. We fall into something because we're hurting. We need medication. We need, that's what challenges all of us. But you see, that's what God brought Abraham out of. And that's what I came to preach this week, and you may get into next week. So when God is saying, I'm going to make your wilderness like Eden and your desert like the garden of the Lord, and for me to do it, you need to look at Abraham, you need to look at Sarah, so you can understand how I operate. This is it. He went to Egypt. And then we learned that's what, and the moment he started going into Egypt, that's when the glory lifted from him. And his naturalness kicked in. When he was in the land of Canaan, he wasn't afraid of anybody taking his wife. He wasn't afraid of the inhabitants of the land. That's how you know you're in the right place. How do you know you've gone into the wrong place? That's when you become conscious of the environment. You're afraid of everything. You start watching everything and, you know, protecting yourself. Unfortunately, and yet we don't recognize that something had gone wrong. So Abraham said, now, okay, Sarah, remember the plan we made? Say that you're my sister, you know, so that for the people will spare my life because you're a pretty woman and all of that stuff. So this happens, and Sarah ends up in Pharaoh's house as he anticipated. You see, he was a prophet of God. God was giving him unction what was about to happen. And instead of turning around, he kept going. Those are the mistakes we have made with our father Abraham. And God said, now, if you want me to turn your wilderness into Eden, your desert into the garden of the Lord, then you need to look at these mistakes and don't follow it. Don't go back to Egypt. You notice it happened in Isaac's life when he, to encounter famine, he wanted to go to Egypt, and the Lord stopped him. Hallelujah. What Egypt have you gone to? Most of you in the third world where you can't move anything except you give bribes and all this stuff. It's so difficult to get anything done. And then we just cave into it. We don't seek God to understand how we can bring the glory to bear in a corrupt place, in a wicked place, and then have victory. And then when people hear me, they say, oh, it's because you're coming from America. I said, well, come to America to start from scratch. Then you'll understand what we went through. It's not easy anywhere. It's not easy anywhere, my beloved. Okay, please listen. All right. So it came to pass, verse 14, I'm Russian, and when Abraham was coming to Egypt, the Egyptians beheld the woman, that she was fair. The princes also of Pharaoh saw her and commended her before Pharaoh, and the woman was taken into Pharaoh's house. Not good. And he entreated Abraham well for her sake, and he has sheep and oxen, and he asses and men servants and maid servants, and she asses and camels. You notice Abraham had wealth before he left. He wasn't a poor man. God didn't choose a poor man. Yes, the covenant will make us, bring us to wealth, and bring us to sustenance. But don't teach that the Abrahamic covenant is a financial thing or a material thing. No, it's a glory thing. It's a blessing thing. It is the final word that the Lord gives, that the glory of God will stand and remake my life and cause my wilderness to become a fruitful field. And the Lord, the Bible says, and the Lord plagued Pharaoh's house with great plagues because of Sarah, his wife, because that's a prophet's wife, you can't touch her. And Pharaoh called Abraham and said, what is this that thou hast done unto me? Why didst thou not tell me that she was thy wife? Why sayest thou she's my sister? So I might have taken her to me to wife. Now therefore, behold thy wife, take her and go thy way. So they chased him out again. And Pharaoh commanded his men concerning him, and they sent him away and his wife and all that he had. Now we're coming into what I came for. So you can see, he saw famine, he ran away from it, and now God is sending him back. This is where we begin to put the strategy again in motion. And then I will unveil it. Unfortunately, I only have tomorrow and Friday. But we'll do our best. We just continue next week. We love you. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.